Hachette Audio presents The Phenomenon. Pressure, the Yips, and the pitch that changed my life. Written by Rick Ankiel and Tim Brown. Read by Rick Ankiel.
To my wife, Lori, who helped me to love and trust again. To my sons, Declan and Riker, you have brought me so much happiness. In your lives, you will encounter bumps in the road. I hope this book reminds you to never give up. I love you. To Harvey, with your love and guidance, here's what I did about it. From Tim, for Kelly, and for Connor and Timmy. Introduction. I have two sons. They give me a chance to be good, to be present, to be better. Their names are Declan and Riker. They fish with me, like I fished with my father. He was a great fisherman, near as I remember. Probably still is. They like baseball enough. I loved baseball for a while, then wasn't so sure, then loved it again. Baseball was who I was for a very long time, for better or worse. I'd still recommend it to them, if they were to ask, and it seems they're getting old enough to start asking. They're free to decide for themselves. In the meantime, I'll throw them all the batting practice they want, as long as they promise to be patient and wear a helmet. They are so young, at ages I barely remember. They're good boys. They generally mind their mother, my wife Lori, who occasionally must believe she has three boys instead of two. There might be something to that, me taking a do-over on the childhood thing. Part of me wants a second one that I'll recall with more clarity and warmth. I think all the time about raising two boys, about being good at something as important as being a father. I think about it when they're laughing at the same goofy joke that it makes me laugh, and when they cry on a day when I'm sad too. And when we're just driving down the road in my pickup truck, singing along to Luke Bryan. Maybe they're missing a tooth that day. Their hair's all crazy, and they've half a chocolate donut stuck to their faces. And it makes me wonder how they ever got so perfect. And it makes me wonder if I was ever one of those kids in that rearview mirror, strapped into their seats, so sure that today will be great, that tomorrow will be too, that Mom and Dad will be together forever, and that I'll be there for them forever too. Declan is 5. He likes math, and he sometimes kills time by practicing his ABCs, humming the alphabet song while he's turning Lego blocks into cars and houses and things only he recognizes. He watches American Ninja Warrior on television. He looks like me. We have the same eyes, my grandfather's eyes. When he was born, the nurse bundled him in a blue blanket and set him in my arms, and he was the most beautiful thing I'd ever seen. He blinked up at me, his father, the man who would, I promised, be kind to him forever, and teach him to be kind to others, and love him and try to never disappoint him. I would not call him names. I would not abuse his mother. I would stand behind him when he needed a push, before him when he needed a shield, beside him when he did not. He was the next generation, different than the last, better, I promised, for Declan, my first. He bats and throws left-handed, like me. Riker is 4. He already understands that as the youngest and smallest in the house, he has to be tougher, feistier, and a little more clever than his brother. He is my firecracker. On first reference lately, he'll answer to hot sauce. He also likes whatever Declan likes that day, which seems to be his strategy to get under Declan's skin. Riker is a right-hander. He also came in a blue blanket, with the same promises. We watch baseball when it's on at night. Who are we rooting for, Papa? Declan asks. Well, I say, Papa played with him, and he's nice, so we'll root for them tonight. Or Papa hit a few homers and won some games for that team once, the one wearing red, so we'll hope they win tonight. In the meantime, I'll put Cardinal hats on them and tell them why later. For a few hours, we'll talk about the game and the men who play it, why they play it, and how they got there. We'll high-five the good stuff and try to ignore the losses and make plans to be back on the couch tomorrow night, maybe for more living room wiffle ball. Anything off the chandelier is a home run. Their curiosity about baseball has drawn me back in. Not that I didn't like it, but there was always something else to do. A tiny car race around the carpet, dinner to eat and baths to take and teeth to brush, and a book to read aloud before their breasts would become long and steady and perfect. There were road trips and new teams and new cities and short conversations on the phone when I told them I loved them and I would see them soon. Home in two sleeps, I'd say. And yeah, I tried to hit them a home run tonight. Now we do baseball together, and it's uncomplicated. Some evenings, we'll gather up the fishing gear and carry it to the dock off the backyard. There are snapper and catfish and snook hiding in those depths. The sun's setting and the air's cooler, and whatever's left over from dinner might be on our hooks. You'd be amazed at what a hunk of chicken nugget will bring. In a half whisper, I'll tell them what my father told me about how smart those fish are, and what they're hungry for, and when, and how they seem to know what's coming. The boars are sometimes more interested in the bait bucket, where sardines or greenies or goggle eyes or mullets await their turn on the hook, just as I was at their age. I find myself hoping they love this, the hunt, the wins, the losses, the beauty of it all, because I love it so much, because a father and his boys ought to be able to do this together forever. Some nights, when the water is calm and the lines are taut, they look at me in a way I've never looked at myself. Maybe I'm imagining that, but I like the way it feels. I like what it has taught me about selflessness and accountability, about showing up. I like what it has taught me about myself and what I need to be today and every day after that. See, there is the life you want. There is the life you get. There is what you do with that. Simple, only not. I had what they called a generational left arm, and I knew it from the time I was barely older than Declan. There are plenty of good arms in baseball. There are great arms. There are a few, very few, special arms. I had one of those. The scouts said so. The batter said so. Everyone said so. I couldn't help but believe them. I wanted to be special. That was the life I had. The one I'd live through that special arm, until it wasn't. Mine is the story of what I did with that. It is the story of a childhood that could not be trusted because of a father who could not be trusted. And the story of the arm that carried me away from the years of snarling abuse. I was in the major leagues barely 2 years out of high school. A big leaguer and celebrated phenomenon. That word, at 20. And at 21, the starting pitcher in the biggest game of the only life I ever wanted. It is the story of what happened after that. For on that very day, when I asked my arm to be more special than ever, it deserted me. Maybe I deserted it. For the next 5 years, I chased the life I wanted, the one I believed I owed to myself, the one I probably believed the world owed to me, to the gift that was my left arm, to the work I'd done to help make it special, to the life I thought I deserved. My father watched from prison. I was glad for that. I was especially glad for my mother. It is a story of my fight to return to the pitcher I was. The fight mounted on a psyche, a will, formed as protection against my own father. There were small victories. There were far more failures. Those pushed me deeper into my own mind, into the dark fight or flight corners where the cost in happiness and emotional stability were severe. The fights of my childhood against a drunken, raging father had tracked me into manhood. And now the villain was within me, restless and relentless and just out of reach. For the life I wanted, I thrashed savagely and bled freely. There is a saying that goes loosely like this. Don't fight the man who does not mind what he looks like when the fight is over. There is no winning that fight. That fight never ends. I stood in for 5 years, then fought some more. I wish I could have said at the end, yeah, but you should have seen the other guy. But when I got done fighting, he looked fine. He wasn't even breathing hard. It is the story of some triumph. Maybe I would not be a pitcher, and certainly I would not be the pitcher who had walked to the mound one afternoon in St. Louis a long time before and staggered off. Instead, I would be a ball player. I would start again in my mid-20s, ancient for the lower minor leagues, and I would return to the major leagues on a midsummer night in 2007 as an outfielder. An unfathomable journey, even for me. The guy who'd trudged every inch of it, and I would play the game against the backdrop of the life I'd always wanted while living the life I got. They called me the natural. It never felt that easy. It never felt that pretty, but I loved the story. If there was a comparison to be drawn, I guess I'd be closer to the Roy Hobbs in the book. The one Bernard Malamud wrote, a grittier version of the Roy Hobbs that showed up 32 years later in the movie theaters. I had a past I didn't quite know how to explain and had no desire to. It was too dark in there. It was too personal. Nobody needed to know but me, and I'd already spent too many nights trying to forget. When the time came, be it on the pitcher's mound or in the batter's box, I would face the game alone, just me and the demons. They'd threatened to wreck my career, as they had the careers of plenty before me, and every day I returned to test the demons again.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.